Instagram, which if you're not, I'm not understanding what's good with you, what's up, like it's right there, like stop being lazy. I also posted this on my community tab. I have started my lock journey. Now there are lots of reasons for this. You can go check out the video on my second channel. Yes, I have a second channel. It is predominantly my Haitian based channel. However, there will be more personal content on there. The name of the channel is Chronicles of Azo, just in case you can't get to link. But I will be documenting this lock journey. So if you care, if you want to see Haitian content, if you want to see more personal content, I'm going to be doing vlogs. And also a lot of my advice and story time videos will be moving to that channel as well. I will be keeping this channel more social issues based. So The Mafia Speaks, Girl Talks, story times, any advice, anything like that will be moving to that channel. Now, before we get into all of that, this video is sponsored by the lovely Lashes on My Face, okay? These lashes are from Hortense Hibiscus, and I worked with them on my second channel before, and I have a video putting these on because these are not like any regular lashes, okay? They are magnetic lashes. Like, I did not know I needed lashes till I got a pair of magnetic lashes. I've never put on falsies with glue, but it's always been extremely intimidating for me. I've always been afraid that, oh my God, like my real eyelashes are gonna come out. So I never wanted to like tamper with the glue. So I was so happy when they reached out to me, especially since they are black owned. Like y'all, listen, I'm gonna tell you this right now. These lashes are the bomb and they have different styles to suit everyone's needs. These are my favorite that I have on right now. Like, love them. They're so pretty. And these are like simple, but they're really, really full. I don't really care for really, really long ones, but if that's your style, they got those too. And it's just such an easy process. Put on your regular eyeliner, you put on the eyeliner provided, two layers, and then you use the tongs to put them on and press lightly, and it just sticks on. I wear these all day. I partied with them. I've done all types of shit with them and they stay on. They do not come out. And just in case they do pop off, you can pop them right back on because like I said, they are magnetic. If you want to know more, if you want to purchase more, or if you want to join my giveaway, go follow me on Instagram because I'm running a giveaway right now and I will be ending the giveaway next week. So head over there, follow the instructions in the comment section. But just in case you just want to support a black business, all the information you need is down in the description or in the pinned comment down below. So let's get into the history of wigs and weaves. Looking up the history of locks, I did come across the history of wigs and weaves, extensions, and all of that. Wigs, weaves, and extensions actually date back all the way to 3400 BC. And the oldest findings of these come from the ancient Egyptians. Listen, the ancient Egyptians was out here, okay? They was out here being the most innovative people they could be. And plus, the ancient Egyptians were black, yes. Don't let anyone else tell you different. They don't like to tell us a lot of things. Now, back in the day, the Egyptians wore hair pieces. Sometimes they were just wigs, and they came in all types of different colors. Blue, red, green, of course, black. They would attach these pieces to their hair using beeswax and resin. They used to wear all types of extensions to signify wealth, to signify reign, to signify age, to signify all types of stuff. It was something that the elite were putting in their hair. The royal families were putting in their hair, and they were very, very expensive. Common people were not really able to afford them, but of course the people higher up were able to do so, and they used it to signify their strength and their power. This is also the same with locks, which I'm gonna probably do a whole nother video on that. It was like an accessory for a lot of them. There were also men who would wear extensions. So those of you men out there who happen to be watching this and you want some extensions, go right ahead with your bad self, okay? Reasons I really wanna make this video is because I'm tired of people demonizing people who wear hair extensions and making them seem like they're bad people. But we're gonna get into all of that towards the end of this video. And a lot of men in Egypt would specifically wear them because they would shelter their hair from the harsh conditions in the desert. They would make like hair hats, like they would shave their own head and make like a wig with their own hair and wear it when they were in the desert, as opposed to wearing it on their head, because it would get all this type of stuff in it. They didn't want to really wash it out. So it was way easier for them to just make their own hair into a wig. Fast forward, it hit Europe, and people in Europe were also doing the same thing, wearing the wigs to signify power. But it came a little bit different, because at this point, there were lots of diseases that were rampant, specifically in the Victorian era and before that. There were lots of diseases that would cause people to lose their hair. And the elite can't be walking around bald, okay? That's embarrassing. So they would really seek out these wigs. Like if you really look at pictures from back then, if you really pay attention, you'll see a lot of these ancient paintings and portraits. And oh wow, like is that a wig? Yeah. It's a wig, especially those powdery white wigs. In the 1700s, that's when the whole powdered wig situation came about. Powdered wigs were called perukes. I don't know how to say it, but this word, that. Many of them were made to hide the baldness from the syphilis that was going around at the time. And at this point in Europe, it became a trend for the powerful and the elite to wear wigs. Now, moving on to the Romantic era, the wigs started to get a little bit more advanced, okay? Now, Apollo knots were popular. It had a tighter curl that was like attached to the scalp. In the early 1900s, they had switch, which what we would compare to now as hair clips. Yes, they had hair clips back then too, and these were extremely popular because clearly they're temporary. You don't have to like keep them on your head and, you know, have the process of taking it out. It was literally clip in and clip out. These were usually made of human hair, and they cost about $25 in the 20th century. Not sure how much that was, but I would assume that that isn't cheap back then. Other popular weaves were like frisette, plaits, and like I said, switches. By the 1940s, the hair extension industry blew up. These extensions were in high demand because people just wanted to have longer hair. They wanted to be seen as more beautiful because, as you guys know or may not know, hair is very, very important in many cultures, and longer hair signified a lot of things for a lot of people, even in the 40s. Fast forward to about the 1950s, a black woman named Christina Jenkins came up with the idea of sewing in hair weave. Now, this became so popular that she was flued out, okay? She was flued out to numerous places to do people's hair. People were so mesmerized by this new way of doing hair. Now, before Christina had came up with the whole sew-in situation, hair extensions were actually adhere to your head using hairpin, and that's not really always stable, so this was very, very revolutionary. Over time, hairdressers basically made her sew-in better, improved it, and made it look more natural, made it less bulky. The 1960s encouraged the era of the big hair. You know, that was like, you know, the beehive styles. Of course, by the 80s, that's when relaxers and everything became way more popular. Even though relaxers were definitely founded before then, but in the 80s, the 90s, that's when it really exploded. Fast forward, Asia is now the biggest distributor of hair weave, wigs, and extensions, as we already know. However, it does come with a price for certain people. Now, as you guys heard in this video, wigs, weaves, extensions have been important to many, many people for many, many years. And that is not only because of power, money, and status, but because some people just really like to experiment. They like to have different looks, and they don't really want to damage their real hair. Even though back then, wigs and weaves were actually very, very detrimental, and they can cause a lot of damage to your hair, including bald spots, irritation, because they were literally putting these onto their heads using a resin and beeswax and whatever else, and hairpins, which can all cause tension and breakage to your hair. But still, people were doing it because, you know, they didn't want to go bald, they wanted to look nice, whatever the case may be. So now that everything is a lot more advanced, these are now used by Black women or Black people in particular as protective styles. Now these are really, really easy and really, really effective because you literally just have to pop it on and go. It's not that much of a task for a lot of people. Even though I do believe that people just need to literally just love their natural hair and learn how to do it, it couldn't be extremely convenient to just pop a wig on. We all know this. Now, since the wig and weave industry is literally a multi-million dollar business, pressing the hair can be really cutthroat. And a lot of the hair actually comes from agents going to impoverished neighborhoods trying to get women to sell their hair.
Tóc này á, là cũng nhiều người họ đến hỏi lắm rồi, nhưng mà không bán, trả rất là thấp.
Because for the previous times, they only offer about $2 or $3 for her hair.
That's like actually criminal.
Cái chú này đến hỏi là trả giá cao cho nên đồng ý bán.
Behind many of these wigs and extensions is a woman making the tough choice to sell her hair to better her life.
They go into these neighborhoods where they know the people need the money and they, you know, try to convince them to sell their hair and they give them a small amount of money. Now, honestly, the money that they give them is usually nowhere near worth what it should be for what they're going to sell the money for to people in the States or in other countries. But I mean, it gets worse. Also, reports of men forcing their wives to chop their hair off in order to make money for the family, and stories of children being tricked into shaving their heads in order to receive toys. And there have been instances of foreign gangs actually kidnapping people or beating people, holding them down, cutting their hair in order to sell it for profit. So yeah, the hair business could be really, really brutal depending on where we're talking about and how the hair is sourced. There are also places such as Southern India where a woman voluntarily shave their heads and some hair is collected that way as well. Nonetheless, hair is very, very important to a lot of people. Whether you are for hair extensions, for a bald head, for hair, whatever, I think it's very, very important to understand the reasonings behind people's feelings about that. We have always heard people bash Black people, women predominantly, for wearing hair, wigs, weaves, and extensions. We are often called insecure, we are often called, you know, lazy and all of that, and to an extent, this can be true. I know plenty of women who cannot walk out their front door without having a wig on their head. Kid you not, I have experienced this with a lot of my friends. They will not go outside if they do not have a wig on. Like, they get real, real upset, they get real, real offended, and they'll get really, really, like, antsy about going outside. So for some people, I do believe this is the case. However, for many people, they just want to keep their hair protected because that's what it's called. We call it protective styling. When your hair is kept up braided, if your hair is kept up in a wig or whatever, you're gonna have less breakage, less split ends, and all of that extra stuff. So when you keep it up and out of the way, you don't really have to worry about it. You don't have to tamper with it and risk damaging your hair. And you know, it's just easier to style. Some people genuinely just like different looks and they don't want to put those looks on their head itself. For example, if I want purple hair, why would I have to dye my hair purple? And I can just get a wig, you feel me? A lot of people wear wigs and weaves as a way to create convenience for them and a way to express themselves or a way to just combat breakage, whatever the case may be. A lot of people don't really think that deep into. There are a few reasons why wigs, weaves, and extensions became popular within the Black community. There's plenty of others, you can look it up, are clearly the discrimination amongst Black people and people outside of the Black community. Now, as you know, during slavery and everything else that Black people have went through, they have been constantly told to change themselves from their skin color to their hair, whatever the case may be. Nothing a Black person ever did or ever was enough back then. And their hair was probably something that was the easiest for them to fix. It was a lot easier to just, okay, well, I mean, I'm Black, I can't really change that, so let me change my hair. And a lot of people did this in order to be accepted more by society. They did this to get jobs because they were being discriminated against, not only for being Black, but because of their hair. Afro hair was seen as unruly. It was seen as unprofessional. It was seen as disgusting, dirty, and all of this extra shit. I mean, let's be real here. Has much changed? Has much changed? We're talking about like probably 100+ years ago. Has much changed? Comment down below. You decide. I don't see much of a change. A lot of us still do. Oh my God, I have a job interview. Let me straighten my hair. Oh my God, I'm going to go to this business meeting. Let me pop on a straight wig. That's sad that to this day in 2020, we still have to be like, oh my God, like, let me cover my hair. Let me do something to my hair so it's seen as more acceptable to someone else who may not understand me. That's a problem. And back then, it was even worse. I feel like it's not that bad now, but I feel like now it's been ingrained in us, so a lot of us just keep that mentality. Like, I'm sure all of us have had that experience where it's like we do our hair, but then all of a sudden someone asks us like, oh my God, what are you gonna do to your hair? Trust me, it's happened to me. I've done a twist out, or I'm just wearing it in an afro and I'm thinking I look cute, and they're like, oh, what you gonna do to your hair, girl? And it's like, oh, I thought it was done. Like, you know, it's ridiculous. I touch more on this in a discussion with my friend on my second channel. Not sure if it's gonna be up before this one, but if not, go subscribe to the channel anyway. But yeah, it's really, really sad. Now, a lot of people are against this because they feel like if you wear wigs, weaves, or any other type of extensions, you are perpetuating the idea that black is not beautiful. You do not embrace your hair. You are not for the people, okay? You are not for the cause. You are basically submitting yourself to white supremacy and social standards that are not your own. And you know, we've seen a lot of this in the eras of people wearing the afros and, you know, protesting, you know, way back then. You know, it was not only a form of protest against, you know, what was going on and all the social inequality. It was a protest to fuck your social norms. We're gonna do what we want. We're beautiful. It is what it is. So over time, people really demonize them for that. So that's why you really see a decline of the afro or any type of natural hairstyles. Even now, when you see natural hairstyles, what are they? They're sleek, they got the baby hairs, they're making their curls pop. Like, have you really noticed, like, you don't really see many puff type of hairstyles. You don't really see afro puff hairstyles, how to keep your puff in shape. You don't really see that because it's always been frowned upon. Because when you wear it, you're looked at as, oh, well, why your hair look like that? Oh, your hair is unruly. Now there is the spiritual aspect. There are many people who are spiritual and believe that wigs, weaves, and extensions actually weigh a person down. Now, by spiritual, I'm not talking about like church spiritual. I'm talking about spiritual as in the universe, energy, and all of that. Now, I'm gonna get into religion after this, but in the spiritual realm, a lot of people believe that wearing weaves, wigs, and anything else on your head for an extended amount of time can block your receptors. For those of you who do not know, your hair actually holds a lot of power and a lot of energy because it is out and about and it absorbs stuff. So when you're out, your hair is absorbing solar energy. When you're asleep, your hair is absorbing lunar energy. And those who are spiritual believe that since all of these energies are flowing in your head, not only from you and from whatever higher being you believe in, these are all attached to you. And your hair is a receptor for messages that are meant for you and things that are supposed to happen to you. You are trying to connect with a higher being, being a better version of yourself. You cannot do that when you have wigs, weaves, or anything else constantly blocking your hair shaft or your scalp. Your hair is not going to be able to be penetrated to receive the messages and the energy that is meant for you. Let's really think about it. Think of the possibility that your hair is actually not just here to look good. It may actually be there to protect you, enlighten you, and connect you to a higher spiritual being. Just like there are certain people in certain cultures who believe that you should never cut your hair, and they have like this hair all the way down to their knees, you know? And that's because they believe that their hair is really, really important and does a lot of things for them. Some people do still hold the ideology of hair does signify wealth and all of this other stuff, but a lot of people keep their hair really, really long because many people believe that you should never cut your hair because you should let it keep growing until it stops at the length that is meant for you. Yes, there are some people that literally just don't grow hair, and that's probably the length for them. There's some people that their hair just keeps growing and growing, and they are supposed to keep it that way. From a yogic standpoint, those that are really into yoga and stuff like that, many of them believe hair is an amazing gift of nature and can actually help raise Kundalini energy, which is the creative life force, and increases tranquility, vitality, and intuition within you as a person. Many of them believe when you let your hair grow to its mature length and let it retain all its nutrients and vitamins, you are then able to become a better person. And the science behind this is that the vitamins that are in your hair, okay, all of the nutrients in your hair enter your lymphatic system in your body. This lymphatic fluid and eventually the spinal fluid travels through the ducts in your brain. This ionic change creates more clarity, stamina, and all of this creates you having a well-balanced mind. You'll be a clearer thinker. You'll have more energy. You'll be more tranquil. I hope I'm saying that right. He brought his version of Kundalini yoga to the US, made it popular. He died quite a while ago, but a lot of people really believe in the research that he did. And he believed that if you do cut your hair, you lose the extra energy and nourishment that your hair is bringing you. But not only that, it will take 3 years to replace all of this energy. And now you will be pushing your body a lot harder in order to replenish this energy. Like I said before, a lot of people believe that hair is an antenna. You channel the sun energy specifically. Your frontal lobe is specifically important for your visualization and your meditation properties. They bring you greater quality of cosmic energy. So instead of cutting your hair, they believe that you should just, you know, apply some oil and get out the way. Even split ends. They don't believe in that whatsoever. They believe you should keep all your hair on your head. Other beliefs that he shared was that you should wash your hair quite frequently. You should never go more than 72 hours without washing your hair, especially when you went through bouts of extreme emotion. Another thing would be the direction you comb your hair into. You have to brush your hair from front to back or from right to left. All this, there's a lot of things that go into it. I'm going to leave some articles down below. It's very, very interesting when you really, really look at the energy and the power that hair really holds, depending on if you believe in it or not. Now let's get into the religious aspect. If you haven't met a religious person, like I'm talking about extremely religious person who is against wigs, weaves, and extensions, God bless your soul, you do not want to come across these people. It's a lot, but I completely understand. A lot of religious people believe that you should remain the way God has intended. That means no nail polish, no tattoos, no body alterations, but especially no hair, wigs, weaves, or extensions. Doesn't matter what the special occasion is, doesn't matter where you're going, what your problem is, doesn't matter if you're going bald. If God intended for you to be like that, that's how you stay. These are typically really radical people, really, really radical, strong into their religion. This could be a lot of different people. I've met a lot of Baptist people who are like this. I've met Jehovah's Witnesses who are like this. I've met Methodist people who are like this. So it could be any type of religion. I also met a couple Muslim people who believe in this as well. So it could be any religion. It just depends on what they were brought up as, what they believe in, and you know, a whole lot of other stuff. A lot of people who are deep into their faith with God or any higher being believe that they should come, remain, and go as they came. And that's that. Anything else will block your entrance with the God that you believe in the afterlife. You will not be blessed. You will block your blessings. You will not be able to communicate with God effectively because you have changed yourself. You have altered yourself. You do not love yourself the way you are. Like, that's how a lot of them believe. And I mean, if that's their opinion, that's their opinion. You don't have to agree with it. If you feel like that, then that's how you feel. But it's not okay to demonize people for what they choose to do. Whatever it is that you choose to do or not to do, just make sure you do your thorough research on it and you do things for you, not anyone else. You do what you want to do. But even if you're doing what you want to do, understand why you are doing it. Don't just be like, oh, I'm gonna wear this wig because I want to. But why? And then assess the why and go from there. With that being said, comment down below. Did you know about the history of wigs, weaves, whatever the case may be? Did I miss anything? Do you want to add anything? Have you had anyone try to demonize you for wearing weaves, wigs, or extensions? Doesn't matter if you're white, black, whatever the case may be. Comment down below. I'd love to hear your thoughts and opinions. Make sure you like, share, subscribe, do all that. And I'm going to see y'all next time.